Hello everyone, Ryan here with another episode of The Natural Aquarium right here on Father Fish. Today we're going to go back into one of those popular things that we do in natural aquariums, and that's add leaves. I've got myself a lovely alder leaf right here, and today we're going to explore two big ideas, and the first one is around what are the substances that these are emitting that create colors, and what do they do for our aquarium? And then the second one is how do these things degrade? What is it that happens when they do? So, if you're interested in that, tune in right here for another great episode of The Natural Aquarium. So this experiment is centered around six different types of leaf litter. We're going to test them both for the humic substances that they release, and then also we're going to test them for how fast they break down in an aquarium. And you might say, humic substances? What? Not tannins? Yeah, humic substances. It's the real deal, okay? Tannins have been oversold. This is the stuff in science. And so we start off and we are going to be basically putting out a quarter gram. I don't know why I settled on that number, but hey, it worked. So we got a quarter gram of all these different leaf species here. And while we're weighing out the rest of our leaves, I probably caught your attention with the fact that we're talking about humic substances here and not tannic. Tannins, it's that stuff that you've heard about all over the web, right? Anytime you type in leaves and aquarium, you're gonna get tannins everywhere. Well, I went and I did a whole bunch of research. It took a while, and I had it verified by one of our other folks. Maiev, you're the best. And so, anyways, I was finding over and over again that the humic substances were the ones that had multiple peer-reviewed studies and had evidence on things like fish immune function, pathogen resistance. Even fry survival came across a wonderful study with some cichlids, and if there are humic substances present, guess what? The eggs did better. Oh, and then after that, yeah, the fry did better as well. So, unfortunately, yeah, tannins, they became the big meme, and a lot of what people are attributing to them should be attributed to our humic substances instead. So for our water source in these leaves, I chose distilled water simply because I didn't want there to be any other strange reactions occurring. I just wanted it to just be the humic and, you know, tannic substances, whatever it is that's coming out of these leaves, to be the only thing that was being affected. And so we poured up 200 milliliters of this stuff into every one of our test jars here, and then put in our leaves, and then it just took a while for everything to happen. And here you go, next part. So of course, next step is to have everything labeled up, and if you wanted to know my little shorthand, here it is. We've got AS for American Sycamore, we've got a Magnolia leaf being M, our Alder leaf being AL, our Indian Almond leaf being IA, our Alder Cones being AC, and then last but not least, our good friend the Cottonwood being just C by itself. So the cool thing to gain from this is that you can see at the rough rates of when all of these colors are going to appear. So if you put these leaves into your tank, what you can expect over time. And the other thing is that you will find that they each release different shades due to the different humic and tannic compounds that they may contain. So if you are a connoisseur of watercoloring, this would be valuable information to you. I've also got it on suggestion from Maiev that if you want to add winemaker's tannins, it's a great way to get some specific colors. And then from Tommy, as well as some other sources on the web, there are a lot of folks that are into just adding some rooibos tea to get specific shades as well. So to each their own, may the colors serve you well. Now the other cool thing that goes along with these is that we are going to be able to see also their rough breakdown rates as well. It tends to be pretty correlated with how fast they release their colors. Not 100% correlation here, of course, it is biology, everything's a little bit different. But yes, those that tend to release their colors a little bit faster, you will notice in our second segment that they will be the ones that have broken down faster. And there's also a relationship there. It tends to do with the actual structure of the leaf. Leaves that are more dense and also have like waxy type coatings and stuff, those coatings and everything protect the leaf, makes it harder for our lovely fungi and bacteria and other things that are breaking them down to do that job. And so they tend to last longer, especially our American sycamore that we have in this particular experiment. You'll notice that not much happens there. Same thing with our magnolia one, not much happening. So for the next portion of this experiment, after all of our colors had been leached out, for the most part, of course, some of them will take longer, I went and just plunked all of the beakers along with their contents straight into my 20-gallon aquarium filled with shrimp, snails, and Endler's live bearers. And here's the results after all of those days of just sitting in the aquarium. Cottonwood was our number one for breakdown rate. Barely any is left. So the alder cones did not break down very much visibly. These will take much longer because, of course, they have less surface area compared to the volume. Alder leaves came in second place just behind the cottonwood as far as the amount of breakdown that happened. Indian almond leaves came in third place as far as breakdown, right behind our alder leaves. It was mostly the soft underparts of the magnolia that ended up being decomposed. As far as our American sycamore, it was the one that just did not get broken down much at all. Next time you observe an aquarium and it seems to be that the water is a little brown or yellow or something like that, well, you can thank your humic substances, and they are great. They are helping your fish and all the rest of the inhabitants. There's multiple studies out there that even look at the lowly nematode, for instance, being benefited by some of these. And all of these pieces of leaf litter, like the sweet gum pod that these shrimp are investigating, all the way to the leaves that we tried in our beakers, they are all going to break down and be food sources. Maybe not directly, but the things living on top of them could be, or the things that are chomping away, making them smaller and smaller, like our friend the scud here, They need a place to live. Otherwise, well, guess what? They're going to be eaten by your fish very quickly. So if you can keep a nice pile of leaves in your aquarium, you can keep some of these beneficial humic substances and keep some of the things that eat them around so that your fish have free food. And there we have it, folks. It's about time for you to leave me alone. Oh, but before you do, don't forget to leave that lovely little like and maybe a comment about what's your favorite leaf to put in an aquarium. And don't forget to hit that lovely little subscribe button somewhere down there. And we will see you again for another episode of The Natural Aquarium right here on Father Fish. Until then, we'll see you.